The writer is waxing eloquent on the great qualities of the Gessler brothers. After praising him or praising the brothers for the excellent work that they do, the writer says, when one grows old and wild and runs up bills, one somehow never ran them up with Gessler brothers. When one grew old and wild and ran up bills means accumulate your bills without making payment. You buy things without paying the money. As a result, your bills get accumulated. A man does it when he becomes old and mad, wild. Even if people run up bills with other shopkeepers, nobody would run up their bills with Gessler brothers. The writer is trying to say that though we run up our bills with other businessmen, other shopkeepers, we will never feel like running up the bills with Gessler brothers, because it would not have seemed becoming to go in there and stretch out one's foot to that blue iron spectacle glance, owing him for more than just say 2 pays, just a comfortable reassurance that one was still his client. Now the writer gives a reason why nobody runs up bills with the Gessler brothers. It is because it would have seemed unbecoming, inappropriate. It would not have seemed becoming appropriate. So that would have been inappropriate for anybody to go to Gessler brothers, stretch out his foot to that blue-eyed man. You know, we have been told that the Gessler brother has got blue eyes. He is wearing thick spectacles. So blue iron spectacle glance owing him more than just say 2 pays or just a comfortable reassurance here, confidence or pride that one was still his client. Now the writer gives 2 reasons why people don't run up their bills with the Gessler brothers. The first reason is that it would seem unbecoming, because you know, the cobbler here, Mr. Gessler, is not a rich man. He transacts his business from a small shop in a narrow street in London. Moreover, he is seriously involved in his work and he makes the best possible shoes. So you won't feel like running up your bills with him, because he is such a decent, dignified man. The second reason is that anybody will have the pride or reassurance that he is a proud customer of Gessler Brothers. So 2 reasons are given to show why nobody runs up bills with Gessler Brothers. The first thing is that they are too decent to be cheated. So nobody will feel like cheating them, because they are very dignified, they are very good, and they are very good at their work. Second reason is that the people want just the reassurance or the pride of being the clients of the Gessler brothers. A man who buys shoes from him will have the pride of saying, I am the customer of Mr. Gessler. So that's why nobody feels like accumulating his bills with this great person, great cobbler. for it was not possible to go to him very often. His boots lasted terribly, having something beyond the temporary, some, as it were, a sense of boot stitched into them. This is the third reason why nobody runs up bills with him. What's the third reason? It is not possible for anybody to go to the cobbler very often. See, you can't run up your bills unless you go to your shop so many times. With Mr. Gessler, you can't run up your bills because you hardly go to him. Suppose a customer goes to him today, he'll be going to him again after 2 years. So, such a situation, running up bills doesn't become a necessity. For it was not possible for anybody to go to him very often. What's the reason? People don't go to him very often because his boots lasted terribly. They are highly durable. Once you buy a pair of shoes, then you won't go to him for another 3 years or 5 years or 10 years. His boots lasted terribly. Having something beyond that temporary, his shoes look something beyond the temporary. You get a feeling that his shoes are permanent. They don't belong to this world. They are immortal, as if the essence of boot is stitched into them. You get an impression, you get a feeling that Mr. Gessler's shoes have the essence of shoes stitched into them. So they are eternal. They stand for eternity, permanence. One went in, not as into most shops, in the mood of please serve me and let me go, but restfully, as one would enter a church. Now the writer says how a customer goes into his shop and transacts his business or does his business. One went in, a customer went in to Mr. Gessler in the mood of, not in the mood of, please serve me and let me go. You go to any other shop in the mood of, please give me what I want, then I'll go. You won't spend more than half an hour in any shop. Okay. So you'll be in the mood of telling the salesman or shopkeeper, please give me what I want, I'll go. But if you go to Mr. Gessler, you will have enough time in the world. So you restfully, having all the time, with so much of patience, you enter his shop as you would enter a church or any other religious place. So as soon as you get into his shop, you sit on the single wooden chair. So there is one chair kept for the customers to be seated. So you enter his shop, sit on the wooden chair kept there, for there was nobody ever there. You won't find any other customer or anyone else downstairs. You will find just one chair, so there isn't much rush in the shop. The shop is not crowded. So you walk into his shop, sit on the single wooden chair kept for the customers. Soon, over the top edge of that sort of well, rather dark, smelling smoothingly of leather. The shop smells of leather because a cobbler works with leather. So the entire shop has got the smell of soothing, comfortable, good smell of leather, which from the shop they would be seeing his face, and on the top you can see the face of Mr. Gessler or his elder brother. If he is not there, his elder brother will look at you. peering down, looking down from the top. So as soon as you enter the shop, you are seated on the wooden chair. Hearing the noise, the man from above will look down, either the younger brother or the elder brother. Then you will hear a guttural sound. Mr. Gessler has got a harsh sound, guttural sound. He'll talk to you in that guttural sound. And the tip-tap beating, the sound of the bast slippers beating the narrow wooden stairs. So you will hear a guttural sound, then the tip-tap of bast slippers beating the narrow wooden stairs. You will hear the guttural sound and the sound of tip-tap. Tip-tap, the beating sound of the bast slippers. Bast slippers, slippers made of a fiber. Bast is a fiber that is taken up from a tree. A woody, fibrous material made from certain plants and trees. Look at this. Mr. Kessler never wears shoes. He sells shoes, but he wears bast slippers. So when he walks up and down, it makes a tip-tap, it makes a sound. So the customer sitting down will know that he is coming down to talk to him, hearing the tip-tap of bast slippers. And he would stand before one without coat. So he would stand before the customer without a coat. You can't see him wearing a coat. He's a little bent and in leather apron. He's a man who is seen always wearing a leather apron. Apron is a piece of cloth that is worn in front of your clothes so that your clothes will get protected while you're working. So he's always seen wearing this leather apron with the sleeves turned back. Sleeves are turned back, blinking, looking as if awakened from some dream of boots. So when you sit on the wooden chair, he will know that there is a customer in. Then he'll come climbing down the staircase. He will look at you into your eyes with his blue eyes, and he looks as if he will look at you blinking. He'll blink at you as if he's awakened from some dream of boots. So looking into his eyes, you will feel, or you will think, that this man must have been awakened from a dream of boots. Or like an owl. So there are two comparisons. There are two things that he says about this man. One thing, he looks as if awakened from the dream of boots. Or he will look like an owl, surprised in daylight and annoyed, disturbed at this interruption. So he looks like an owl. When he comes down and talks to the customer, he will have the look of frightened, look of an owl who gets disturbed during the daytime in daylight. You know, an owl sleeps during the daytime and wakes up at night. And if somebody disturbs an owl, he will have a surprised look on his face. And in the same way, the cobbler comes and talks to a customer with a look of surprise on his face, as if he's disturbed or as if he's interrupted. And the customer, I would tell him, now the writer goes there as a customer, "How do you do, Mr. Gessler? Could you make me a pair of Russian leather boots?" So I won't ask him anything else. Straight away, I'll come to the point. After asking, "How do you do, Mr. Gessler? Could you make me a pair of Russian leather boots?" So without wasting time, the customer asks him whether he could make him a pair of Russian leather boots. In reply, he would say nothing. Without a word, he would leave me. Okay. So when I ask him whether he could make me a pair of Russian boots, he doesn't give any reply. Instead, he goes back, he goes up, he would leave me, retiring hence here from where he came. He came from above, so he goes back into the other portion of the shop. Without a word, he would leave me, retiring from where he came or into other portion of the shop, or I would continue to rest in the wooden chair, inhaling, smelling the incense smell of his trade, the smell of leather. So without a word, he would leave me after I placed the order. He may go back to the place where he came from, or he will go to the other side of the shop, portion of the shop, and the customer would have to continue sitting in the wooden chair, enjoying the smell of the fragrance of his trade, that is leather. Soon he would come back. After he waits for some time, he would come back holding in his thin veined hand a piece of gold brown leather. So the cobbler will come back after some time carrying a piece of gold brown leather in his hand, on which you can see the veined hand. With his eyes fixed on it, he would remain looking. He won't look at the customer. His looks are glued to, his eyes are glued to the leather, and he would remark, looking at the leather, gold brown leather, he would remark, what a beautiful piece. Looking at his gold brown leather, piece of gold brown leather, he would say to the customer, oh look, what a beautiful piece of leather it is. When the customer too had admired it, he would speak again, when do you want them? After the customer also tells him that it looks beautiful, then he will ask the customer, when do you want them? Then I would answer, the customer would say, as soon as you can finish, I'll be happy to have it. Then he would say, all right, tomorrow fortnight. So he says, 14 days from tomorrow, I'll deliver the shoes after 14 days from tomorrow. So 14 days from fortnight means 2 weeks from tomorrow. Or if you were his elder brother, so the younger brother is in control of the shop. If the younger brother is not in the shop, he would tell the customer, I'll ask my brother and will let you know when exactly the shoes can be delivered. If it is a younger brother, on the spot he would say 14 days from the next day.